Museum Roadshow on BCTV is supported by the Edward J. Kuhn Funeral Home, Incorporated.
Hi, and welcome to the winter edition of Museum Roadshow. I'm Mike Anderson, the Public Relations and Marketing Director at the Reading Public Museum. And as usual, we have a couple of location segments on today's program, and we'll get to them in just a few moments. But first, let me remind you about a couple of the exhibitions that we have currently on view right now at the museum and throughout the entire holiday season as well. In our science gallery, continuing through January 4th, you'll see Jelly Belly Endangered Species Series, which includes five portraits from the Jelly Belly Art Private Collection, each a sweet replica of an exotic species rendered completely in colorful Jelly Belly jelly beans. Pretty unique. And in addition, we've displaying some of our own taxidermy mounts from our own private collection, or private, it's open to the public now, representing animals that are or were endangered, extinct, or protected under a conservation program. Another exhibit continuing also through January 4th is the American President Photographs from the Archives of the Associated Press, and it showcases over 70 of the finest works by legendary photographers of the Associated Press, or the AP, which is the world's oldest and largest news agency. You'll see them in our new Minded Gallery in the first floor, and our Works on Paper Gallery as well downstairs. Also, check out Call to Duty World War Posters, also through January 4th. This exhibit includes over 70 original World War I and original World War II posters drawn from our own extensive permanent collection as well. And these posters help to tell the story of the massive human efforts put forth during these two world wars. They originally displayed in public locations. The posters and the messages they communicated were found throughout the United States. Later in the show, we'll get a brief tour of the exhibit. It's a fascinating show. We hope you are able to catch it. Also, there's an exhibit called Deadly Medicine, Creating the Master Race. It's also on display through January 4th, and it examines how the Nazi leadership, in collaboration with individuals and professions traditionally charged with healing and the public good, and how they used science to help legitimize persecution, murder, and ultimately genocide. To relate this history, the United States Holocaust Memorial Museum has assembled this very moving exhibition, and it's a very good complement to the Call to Duty exhibition right on the second floor in our temporary galleries. Recently, we had the chance to talk with Dr. Patricia Herberer-Rice about this exhibition and its relevance to today's medicine. So let's take a look at what she had to say. Hi, we're here with Dr. Patricia Herberer-Rice. She's a historian with the United States Holocaust Memorial Museum. Boy, that's a mouthful.
It is a mouthful.
And quite a job. You've been there for 20 years.
20 years this August, and, so quite a long stay.
And your specialist is in the Nazi eugenics program, the medical side of that, and you've been doing
correct.
A lot of research. And it's, wow, what a way to spend 20 years. It must be a very... exhilarating but scary job.
It's an interesting job, really. It's an interesting profession because we are able to give faces to the victims and we are able to give some closure sometimes to relatives. So
right.
It has its good sides.
Well, that's
too.
Good. Yeah. That's good. Now, we have the exhibit here, Deadly Medicine,
right.
Creating the Master Race. And your talk here today at the museum was specifically on the medical side, and talking about eugenics, and I think the whole exhibit is based on eugenics,
right.
And it tells a story as you travel through the exhibit itself from the beginning, which was the early 20s, late teens.
Yeah, really sort of the late 19th century, but its heyday is really the teens and 20s, just
right.
As you've said, exactly.
And by the time you get through the exhibit, it takes you into the 40s, like mid-40s.
Right, so the time ending really with World War II, which kind of the Nazi use of eugenics really effectively discredited.
And it's very powerful.
It is a pseudoscience,
it's a
yes.
Very powerful exhibit, very
Thank
moving.
You.
What is eugenics for the...
Well, eugenics is It was a pseudoscience. At the time, it was considered a cutting-edge science for most of the scientific medical communities. Really had its heyday, as I said, in the right around the time before the First World War. It was an international movement, and sort of at the core of the movement's belief system was the idea that human heredity was immutable. It grew a lot out of Darwinist theories of natural selection and survival of the fittest, and it really gets a big kick in 1900 with the rediscovery of Mendelian genetics. So the idea is basically selective breeding. If you can breed a better horse, you can breed a better human being and a better national body, and that's sure. what eugenicists had in mind when they embraced these theories.
It started out so as a very positive thing.
It's sort of a utopian thing, as many sort of scientific movements and political movements do, but of course it left us with really serious ramifications during the Third Reich when the Nazis came and put these ideas into very concrete and radical form.
Yeah. I was surprised to see that America, the United States, was in on it very early.
Yeah.
The idea was a good idea at the time,
yeah,
I think.
It seemed to improve,
take out the best in our
yeah,
race.
There were, as you'll see here, probably in the exhibit, you see a lot of these better baby contests and the idea that having healthy babies and premarital counseling, things which were very generally positive. But with a lot of eugenic measures, there was sort of a negative aspect too. And we had that experience here in the United States with compulsory sterilization in roughly half of the American states,
yeah.
And about 50 to 70,000 Americans sterilized during the period between 1907 and 1950.
So. Yeah. Why do you think this is so important that we revisit this in this context?
Well, it's, I think part of the significance, and I speak a lot to medical communities, and that the German medical community was really sort of at the forefront of the international medical community, and that's a spot where the American medical community is today. And I work with a lot of physicians, scientists, medical schools, just think a little bit more about their role and their responsibilities as physicians. Towards vulnerable patient populations, which would be what
yeah.
the disabled would have been called during the Nazi era today. Nazi physicians helped the Nazi leaders to murder a significant population of disabled individuals. And here they are, today we would turn them vulnerable patient populations,
yeah.
very much the responsibility too of our medical people today. And hopefully, exhibits like this, talks like this will help the medical community perhaps to think about their role, their responsibilities, and to remember a little bit of the history and
right.
victims of these
Have you figured out yet at what point good becomes evil or when to start? What are the
right.
things to look for when you're going a little bit too far
right.
With the theory?
The slippery slope, so
yes.
to speak.
Right.
And I think one of the main red flags is when you stop discourse. As we talked about earlier, eugenics was one of those things that was very popular here in the United States as it was in Germany. We had some of the same very negative eugenic measures like sterilization. But here in the United States, there was a significant discourse over eugenics. There were people who did not believe profoundly in it in the same way that many scientists did at the time. And you had the discourse to kind of discuss whether this was legitimate science or whether they needed to take the field elsewhere. And already in the 1930s, sort of modern science at the time was outstripping pseudo-scientific theories like eugenics. But in the Nazi period, you really had a very single-voice discourse, and so the scientific community can't move on
mm-hmm.
beyond
mm-hmm.
this sort of pseudo-scientific ideas in a lot of places. And there's
right.
the difference. So
well, the
discourse is important.
Technology has changed since
technology
the 40s. You mentioned
changed too, yeah.
with some of the antibiotics that were available
mm-hmm.
after this. So.
Mm-hmm.
But I guess some of the basics are the same. We may be coming against that now with modern healthcare. We have to always be looking at it.
And right, and certainly aged populations. One of the terrible things about the euthanasia programs, murdering of patients, was in the last parts of the program, 1944, 1945, they began actually to murder elderly patients without any kind of pathology, without any kind of serious disabilities. And you kind of look at this euthanasia as a kind of worst kind of triage.
Right.
Right? And you,
yeah.
So the emphasis really where do we put our health care that serves us all best,
right,
and serves us all equally.
Well, it's good that people like you keep looking at it and keep informing people of the, you know, the possible downside of it. The exhibit here that you represent, I guess, as part of the U.S. Holocaust Memorial Museum.
That's a long name.
What do you expect people to experience as they come through here?
Right, a little bit of the history, perhaps things that they didn't know, an aspect of our history at the Holocaust Museum that we represent that's not so well known. To think about, you know, issues that we have today in medicine, healthcare issues, having good coverage, old end of life issues, a lot of the genetic issues that are coming forward today.
Oh, yeah.
I was at a medical school yesterday, and a lot of the students came forward talking about selective breeding with the Nazis,
right,
and with eugenics, and then the kind of selective genetics that's going on, wanting a blue-eyed baby or a girl versus a boy, and our ability to do that sort of thing today and the implications of that.
Like you said, the slippery slope.
The slippery slope.
When to, just to keep an eye on
exactly.
it.
Exactly. You've got to always keep your eye.
And there's much more to see at the museum.
There is.
And you invite people down there.
Yes.
Well, we appreciate you. We appreciate all the insights we've gotten from you and for talking to us today.
Thank you. It was a pleasure to be here.
Thank you, Dr. Rice.
Thank you.
Again, it's on display through January 4th at the Reading Public Museum, so don't miss this very meaningful and very thought-provoking exhibition. We recently invited our curator of art and civilization, Mr. Scott Schweigert, to give us a brief tour of the current Call to Duty World War Posters exhibition. So let's watch.
Thanks, Mike. I'm here in the exhibition, Call to Duty World War Posters, here in the second floor temporary galleries of the Reading Public Museum. And I'm starting at the beginning of the show where the theme is enlistment. So when you go to war, when a nation goes to war, one of the primary resources that they need, of course, is enlistees. And the posters that were used to attract enlistees ranged from the very personal, such as the iconic one next to me with Uncle Sam pointing his finger directly at the potential enlistee, indicating that he wanted him to sign up for the U.S. Army, to inspiration from Hollywood and from the young ladies wearing the uniforms of the Navy and as some sort of enticement for young men. So the resources that were needed for war, of course, the propaganda to get those resources was in part these posters, which were placarded all over every public place, including libraries, post office, schools, factories, shop windows. So the message was everywhere, literally inundating inundating potential enlistees. We also have a great selection of English enlistment posters, which used, in some cases, guilt to get young men to sign up. So this one in particular I love. It shows this young boy who is a Boy Scout who says, "What will your answer be when your boy asks, 'Father, what did you do to help when Britain fought for freedom in 1915? Enlist now.'" So sex, guilt, and the individual plea to the potential soldier were means by which these posters enlisted the resources of troops for the war. This part of the exhibition really focuses on posters which were used to get visitors, get spectators, get citizens engaged with the war effort because of atrocities. The sneak attack in Pearl Harbor in Hawaii carried out by the Japanese. So you see this poster in the center with the strong fist announcing the avenge, you know, the idea to avenge December 7th, meaning America will stay strong even in the face of these atrocities. Using fear of the enemy, remember me, I'm still fighting you, as a reminder to Americans that the enemy is approaching the shores. They haven't forgot that we're their enemy. And they haven't forgotten that there are spies out there that might be listening to conversations. So careless talk got there first. This is a message to folks stateside to watch what they say and who they say it to. The term loose lips sink ships came out of this campaign as well. So the idea was, be vigilant, be careful what you say and who you say it to, because the enemy could be lurking around any corner. In addition to men enlisting in the Army, another resource that you need when you go to war, of course, is money. And these wars, both World War I and World War II, were underwritten in large part by the government issuing liberty bonds that were bought by citizens, which helped underwrite the cost of each of these wars. If you couldn't go to war, if you were too old to enlist, if you were a woman, if you were elderly, if you were impaired in some way, this was a way that you can contribute to the war effort with your pocketbook. And posters used imagery that included patriotic images like this one of the Statue of Liberty. This is Liberty speaking. Billions of dollars are needed and need it now. So there the message is very clear that that no matter what the cost of war, everybody can help contribute to it. So we get patriotic images. We get images of children who used war saving stamps to contribute. These were much lesser value than the Liberty bonds were, but the goal was the same, that everybody could do their part by saving stamps and cashing those in for the war effort. War poster artists also used comedy and humor and cartoons to sort of poke fun at the enemy. And so we see Adolf Hitler and the German guard being sort of turned into these cartoon-like figures as a way to engage the public. Very famously, Norman Rockwell did a series of war bond posters called The Four Freedoms. And we're lucky in this exhibition to have all four of those, which were the freedom of speech, the freedom of worship, the freedom from want, and the freedom of fear. These posters alone raised over $135 million for the war campaign. They were issued as supplements to the Saturday Evening Post. Another way that Americans and Europeans could help the war effort was by conserving and preserving food. So the posters in this section of the exhibition really underscore the message that you can all do your part by eating less meat, by using less flour, and the less you use, there's more for the boys on the front lines and in the trenches. And so these posters convey that message. They also convey the message of preserving food. So vegetable gardens, fruits that could be preserved and saved, anything that could be done at the home, in the home economy that saves a trip to the grocery store, that doesn't take from the food supply, is a contribution to the war. They're giving their all. Will you send them wheat? America, the hope of all who suffer, the dread of all who wrong, save food and defeat frightfulness. There was an equation that the contributions that you made, again, in your cupboard, in the refrigerator, went a long way to helping the war effort. So did planning a victory garden. So schools and communities, planted victory gardens where vegetables were raised. And again, the idea was, if we all pitch in and do our part, we're helping the guys on the front lines. So in addition to the four branches of the military who were engaged in both of these wars, There was also volunteers and service organizations like the YMCA, the YWCA, the Red Cross, the Salvation Army, and other groups who did their part to help the war effort, either through medical supplies or doing something like the Salvation Army did with their so-called donut lassies, the Salvation Army donut lassie, who presented donuts for the troops in the trenches. It was a little taste of home, and during the hardest times of the war, that little taste of home meant the world to those young men. And it gave them the opportunity to sort of soldier through and make it to the next stage in the campaign. In the case of the Y, a place to stay abroad, sort of your home away from home, the message was, again, we're all in this together. The service organizations really rallied behind the troops and helped the war effort. So these posters remind us that the effort was made and that the payback was great for these service organizations. The final section of the exhibition is about women and the contribution that they made to both World War I and World War II. By World War II, they were signing up as cadet nurses in the Cadet Nurse Corps. And again, you can see the images that that are used in these posters are sort of straight out of the fashion and Hollywood magazines. Glamorous young women wearing makeup with their hair all coiffed. So the message was that that young women join and make their contribution to the war. They're helping the effort and they're doing their part, just like the young men on the front lines. Other themes explored in this exhibition, in this section of the exhibition, include women who are the head of household, who are keeping charge of the budgets, who are going to the grocery store, who are keeping, preserving food, again, knitting on behalf of the troops, and the image of a mother with outstretched arms to try to help sell some of the Liberty Bonds was a ubiquitous one during the war effort. Women were called into action in factories and to provide supplies for the war effort in the absence of men. So people like Rosie the Riveter, an icon of this era, really embody the idea that women stepped up and did the job, especially during the Second World War.
Thanks, Scott. Boy, that's just a few of, like we said, over 70 posters. They're original posters. They're not reproductions, modern-day reproductions. They're from the original issue, and they're thematically arranged, as you can see by Scott's presentation. So we sometimes don't realize how important the poster was as a means of communication back in those days. It was obviously pre-internet, pre-TV in a lot of cases, and even in the World War I case, pre-commercial radio broadcasts. So it was a very, very potent way to get the message across. So I hope you've learned a little bit more about your museum and that you'll visit us soon, especially during the holiday season if you have some extra time. You'll find everything you need to know at our own website, readingpublicmuseum.org, including new exhibitions that are opening in late January. Most of these exhibitions we talked about today end January 4th, and we'll be changing over the galleries to include quite a variety of new exhibitions. Like Adventures with Clifford, the Big Red Dog. Kids will like that one. We have one called Spirits of the Passage, the story of the transatlantic slave trade. And we also have one called Backstage Pass, Baron Wolman and the Early Years of Rolling Stone, another photographic exhibition. We have events coming up, too, in January, like Golfing in the Galleries and a lot more. So I encourage you to check out our website, again, readingpublicmuseum.org. And don't forget the star and music shows at our NEAG Planetarium, including our popular Jazz Under the Stars series. We'll be changing over in January to the second Thursday of each month, mainly because of when the holidays fall. We used to have it the first Thursday, but look for us in the second Thursday evening. And we're beginning 1/2 hour earlier. We'll be starting the music at 6:30 with doors opening at 5:30. And the schedule for that is on the website. And remember, museum memberships and the huge, great big poinsettia plants that were grown in our very own greenhouse and on sale in our museum shop, both the memberships and the plants make great holiday gifts, and there are quite a few other things in our museum shop that you might want to stop by before the holidays. They make great gifts, and you'll find that you'll also receive our newsletter, which is quarterly. It's called Museum Road, and I have the latest one that's coming out in December here. We have Clifford the Big Red Dog on the cover, and all you need to know about all the upcoming events through January, February, and March. So that's when we'll be back with a new edition of Museum Roadshow. We hope you tune in, and thanks for watching today.
Museum Roadshow on BCTV is supported by the Edward J. Kuhn Funeral Home, Incorporated.